are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
Hello, friend!
Hello!
Welcome to bOrgCast 11.2 with Peter and Anne-Marie.
Hello!
Hello, we're back. And we start with our coverage for Sons and Daughters. Sons and daughters, love
and laughter, tears and sadness and... Sons
Not
and daughters.
That one, no.
The ties of blood.
Here's my son.
A house divided.
When a father and son do not speak, it means there's trouble between them.
On the field of battle.
Stop pretending to be a warrior.
All I ask is a chance to prove myself.
Worf's own son.
This is war. The Jem'Hadar will cut you to pieces.
Is his worst enemy.
I am not here to call you father.
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
The trailer kind of, I don't know, makes it sound better. I'm afraid I still don't like this episode.
Uh-huh.
Overall. There are bits in it too, like?
Yes, there are elements of it that are good, but it doesn't quite hold together, is my feeling about it as well.
No, there's quite a lot of things that piss me off, and I'll get to them as we go through.
Uh-huh.
Is that all right?
Okay, of course.
Okay. So you start with Dax and Worf kissing, and they're interrupted by Sisko's tippy-tap. This is my first issue.
Yes?
Why is Worf, who's serving under Martok, wearing a Starfleet uniform?
I don't know, but he carries on wearing it, doesn't he?
But if you remember when he first said he was going to serve under Martok, he changed into Klingon uniform, didn't he?
I can't remember that, but...
No, he did.
Uh-huh.
So this is my first issue.
Mm.
We are not given any kind of explanation, and he changes, and then, yeah, you're right, he stays in it, and it
yep.
makes no fucking sense.
It certainly makes him stand out, doesn't it?
Yeah. I mean, it's... If it wouldn't be a problem if he'd accepted the commission and never put on the Klingon
yes.
uniform.
Consistency.
But yeah, no, it doesn't work. Wrong. But then you get a nice scene where basically Jadzia's taking the piss.
She's trolling him again.
She is, but I love it.
Their entire relationship is built on her trolling him and him taking it all too seriously.
Yeah, but... I love the line when he says, "Oh, our life together is not going to be easy." And she says, "No, but it will be fun."
Yeah, and he's got. It doesn't really register that, does it? What do you actually think of that then?
Yeah, well, you don't see. He doesn't show a lot of emotion on his face.
No.
But then he's a bit Hulk-like, isn't he? The whole issue of control and everything.
Hulk-like,
as in, has to keep himself in check in case the big green monster comes out.
Oh right, for now. Right. Yeah. I didn't know it was that colour. It'd be slightly off-putting. As long as it's ribbed for your pleasure, I suppose that's all that matters.
Oh, wow.
Start in the gutter.
Yeah.
Work your way down.
Yeah, probably. And then you have O'Brien and Bashir moaning about the fact they've been on the Ritaran, because the Ritaran rescued them.
Yeah, that it makes that connection, which is nice.
But like O'Brien's like, I am not going to be complaining about Starfleet rations again. Because they've been eating Klingon food. And then you get this nice scene, which I like, between Sisko and Martok, and I like their relationship,
mm-hmm.
just generally.
Try not to get too comfortable lounging around the starbase. We need you back in the fight.
Are you a betting man, General?
One of my many pleasures.
Then a barrel of blood wine says, I set foot on Deep Space Nine before you do.
Done.
Problem with that one is I'm just imagining him down the bookies now betting on horses. Whatever the Klingon equivalent is.
Yeah, but they don't bet a fortune. It's one barrel of blood wine.
Uh-huh.
But I like that. It's like it's a good-natured rivalry between the two of them. And it's, yeah, I like it. I like their relationship. And I realise I could be wrong because they're actors and they could be pretending they get on, but you kind of get the impression that there is a chemistry between the two guys.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that J.G. Hertzler and Avery Brooks get on. But I like it. Anyway, it's a nice scene. And then you find out that Martok has requested 15 replacement crew and he's only getting 5. He complains that war is more fun when you're winning, which I like.
He's been playing a Tatwing too long.
Then you meet the crew, which are another load of zero captains from a Tatwing. Although some of them are additional cards, and Garen isn't a captain, she's an additional card. But anyway.
Uh-huh.
I was like, got her, got him, got him, got him. And one of them is Alexander Rozhenko, and he says he's from No House. And I'm like, well, surely when Worf joined the
apparently
House...
Apparently it doesn't work like that, because he doesn't join till at the end of the episode. So.
Yeah, and the shit bollocky thing I'll come back to in a minute. Well, when we get there. But yeah, he's sort of... So he's there, and it's all sort of, what is he doing there? And then you get this sort of Dimgong hat ritual thing.
I accept your lives into my hands. Glory to you, and to the Empire.
Dimgong ha!
Ding dong, the witch is dead.
Kind of, or is it Dimgong?
Ding dong, merry on high.
Yeah, sort of Christmas. Very I don't seasonal. Know. It was just a bit. Kind of, I suppose it's swearing in like what you did with the air cadets, but in Klingon.
Yes, it's the oath of allegiance.
Yeah, that's what it is. I want a bit part in your life. A walk on would be fine.
So, yes, Alexander's now played by Mark Warden, who can also be seen in Enterprise as a Klingon prisoner, Stargate SG-1, Space Above and Beyond, and apparently all the video games. He's got a very lengthy IMDb page, mostly made up of video games, but obviously his voice is good. They didn't go for the previous... Brian Bonsall, wasn't it? Didn't go for him because they couldn't use him on screen for long enough because of acting laws. So they've gone for somebody a lot older, claiming that Klingons grow up really quickly or something.
I think they've claimed that before, though, to be fair. When they switched from one actor to another in Next Gen...
You're right, it went from...
They claimed that they grew up quicker. Mm. So actually, although it might be like because of actor reasons and whatnot, they have done it before and they have seeded it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not necessarily an issue in that sense.
Oh, and he transfers from the Vornak, which is a Vorchar class.
So that makes
quite
sense.
Quite nice shot of them, a pair of them flying through space. It's cool.
Yeah, we'll get onto some less good Klingon ships in a bit. So yeah, that's your teaser, and it's sort of like, oh, this is Star Trek does soap opera, isn't it?
It is a little bit, yes. As soon as you start dealing with family members, well, that was the moment we knew the Next Generation kind of lost it, hadn't it? Because was it season 7 where practically every episode's about a family member, or was it season 6? I can't remember now. But,
I can't remember. But the thing is, when you get the whole and the end of the teaser kind of thing is Alexander Rozhenko, you kind of expect...
Mickey!
Oh, whatever the
fuck. Hey!
Yeah. Then on Deep Space Nine, you've got...
Terok Nor.
It's Deep Space Nine. You've got a resistance meeting.
Yes, in Quark's, because that's a private place, isn't it? And Jake just waltzes up and says, can I join in? It's like, come on, if he can work it out, anybody can, you idiots.
Yeah. The thing is, though, the thing about meeting in public places is quite common.
Well, surely there's a huge chance of them being overheard. And the pair of them are sat, Odo and Kira, are sort of hunched over the table looking really secretive and plotting and planning like.
Yeah, that doesn't work.
They may as well have a big bloody box of gunpowder behind them. I mean, it's fairly
or
obvious.
A neon flashing sign on the head or something. Yeah, no, I know. But there is a tradition of meeting in public places because...
Well, yeah, you go to a pub, but you find a nice nook, don't you? So that you're being seen in a public place, but people can't hear what you're saying and read your lips and all that.
I would just assume the whole fucking thing was bugged, if that was
bugged,
to be honest. And they don't turn up with an anti-bugging device, do they?
I mean, is it the next story where they're meeting in Kira's quarters? And that's a lot more sensible, let's face it.
Yeah, but if that was me, I'd assume they were bugged.
That too, but they presumably have some blocking devices for that. Anyway, they're talking in the pub about their cunning plans.
Yeah, and then Kira has to go and meet Dekert, and you get some Damar snark, which I like.
There was going to be a bit more of that, and it got cut out.
Oh, that's a shame. I liked Damar snark. And then Zial appears. It's nice to see her again. And on the Rataran, Markov's got orders. He's got to escort a convoy. And he's like...
Convoy! Look, I used it in, what was it, the last episode or the episode before? Don't look at me blankly.
Sorry.
But it's all about the convoys suddenly, Deep Space Nine.
Yeah, but it is in war, though, isn't it?
Yeah, they have a part to play.
you've got Martok being all really excited, which is quite a contrast from when we saw him with the last one with the Rotaran, wasn't it?
Yes.
He lost his nerve a bit then. You know, he's like, no, you know, because there's only them, there's no other ships, it's impossible odds and all the rest of it. Mm-hmm. And he's like, you know, what a time to be alive, and this is what he lives for, which is nice to see Martok back, kind of thing.
Undoubtedly, the best thing about the story is Martok.
Absolutely.
He's so cool in every scene he's in.
He's amazing. And then you find him asking Worf about Alexander. And I was struggling, actually, for a word to describe this.
Plot dump would be the phrase that springs to mind.
No, not the, yes, there's a plot dump. But when you find out that Worf hasn't spoken with him, and you've got Martok saying, you know, it's not good when a father and a son don't speak, I felt that disapproval was too strong a word, but I couldn't quite put my finger on what word I would use to describe Martok's response to what he hears.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Klingon's big on family, so clearly he's not going to be approving of it, so...
Okay, because it wasn't...
You got the impression he was restraining himself from lecturing Worf on his duties as a father.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's clear that he doesn't approve of the way Worf's been...
Yeah.
And, yeah, no great surprise as we find out there's been no contact for 5 years, yeah. For heaven's sake. We got 5 years! Yes, indeed.
So, yeah, Worf summons Alexander and basically says, you don't belong here. Which is true, because we know that Alexander said he didn't want to be a warrior.
I know, this is a sudden turn in his... And it's never explained why he suddenly decided to do this. To explore that, at least the story would be doing something. But no, he's just randomly decided that now he's going to be a Klingon, a proper Klingon. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Even though he's completely ill-equipped to do so.
Yeah. And Worf's questioning him, he's right. It's like, you didn't want to be a warrior. So why are you here?
He's confused.
Yes. And then on Deep Space Nine, Kira, having been invited to a dinner to celebrate Xial's return, initially turns it down. But then she speaks with Xial. And it's clear that for her, the only place that is home is Deep Space Nine. Because she's known as the daughter of the guy who's gone to war with the emissary on Bajor. And so therefore... This is where she is. And Kira can kind of understand that. So in the end, she does accept the invitation that she's going to go to this dinner for her. So not for Descartes, but for Xial. And then we have... I don't know that you can call it getting anal about spaceships, because... Ooh,
can we?
Now it's time to get anal about...
Woo-hoo! Took a trip on the Gemini spacecraft, and we thought about you.
Put the jingle in.
I will, unless I leave it blank like I did in the last episode, stupidly. I got all excited about using that again, got so excited, I left the gap and forgot to put it in. So there was a few seconds silence, that's why, I'm afraid. Don't!
What the fuck are these Klingon egg boxes?
Well, it's very unfortunate because these are actually Cardassian egg boxes. That's the
are
last
they?
Time we
and
saw them.
And they were just being painted a bit green.
Remember when Ducat was in charge of an old Cardassian freighter?
Yeah.
It was one of these. They've just painted them green. And they claim it's because, you know, the Klingon-Cardassian war that they were taken as trophies by the Klingons and now using them for themselves. Or alternatively, you're just saving money, you cheapskates.
Yeah,
they look Cardassian. That's the bottom line. That's
they look like
shape.
Fucking egg boxes. They look like shit. Whichever race is using them,
they do not look Klingon in the slightest.
No, they're crap. I don't like them.
Penny pinching. Abu. Shame.
Shame. Abu. On the Rotaran, Alexander is being bullied
by Chitaag.
Yeah, it's a cool name.
Yes. Although he isn't kind of named after a piggy thing, isn't he?
Oh, yeah. Is Chitaag pig shagger?
In which case, you should have called him David Cameron.
That's his name now.
Yeah.
David Cameron the Klingon.
That's really doing this Klingon as a service, I can't help feeling, but never mind.
And initially, he's like, are you mocking me? And it's like, how thick are you? Yes, of course they're mocking you. But then he does throw the food in pig fucker's face.
Yes, lung in the face. Which is not a phrase I thought I'd ever use.
And then there's a fight. Which, of course, pig fucker wins because Alexander's shit. And then you get this scene where... I suppose you're supposed to think the pigfucker's going to kill Alexander, but as Martok points out later, no, he wasn't going to. He's going to teach him a lesson.
Yes, cuss him up a bit, possibly, but...
But he wasn't going to kill him, but Worf intervenes.
Mm.
not good.
No. And as Chitar, because I'm going to be calling him, quite plainly points out, oh, so you're going to fight the Jemadar for him as well, are you?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Doesn't bloody work. Then you're on Deep Space Nine, and Zial has done some paintings. And
it's Welcome to the Gallery.
Oh, can we do the music?
Yes, definitely.
Oh, man.
That's a very old children's TV reference from this country. Wow.
Yeah, we are old people.
We are.
Yeah. It's both, the influence is both Bajoran and Cardassian, which makes sense for Zial, and she wants to use her art to bring people together. Which is nice, and you can understand it as a principle, but it makes Kira feel very uncomfortable.
Yes, it's all a bit on the nose, isn't it, really? Yeah. We'll be able to cat sitting there going, oh yeah, build those bridges, oh yeah.
I just keep wanting to call him Ducant.
Right.
Because he is, isn't he, really?
He is, yes.
And then you have Worf and Martok on the Rotaran sharing a tankard of Warnog, which you told me was Klingon beer?
Yes, Warnog is, yeah.
Excellent.
Although it does sound like it ought to be eggnog. Klingon eggnog.
What makes it Warnog? Has it got chili in it?
Yes, or something like that, yeah. Something like their coffee, yeah.
Oh, yeah. And Martok says that he lost his first officer when his son walked aboard. Which is, you know, it's true. He's mm-hmm. like, it's not right. Alexander is monitoring the sensors and he says that torpedoes are coming, but they aren't because he forgot to erase a battle drill.
Yeah.
Because he's a twonk.
He used the wrong keyboard shortcut or something.
Oh, I don't know. So, but then Martok is like, you know, he's learned his lesson and better to be too ready than not ready enough. But yeah, he's been accepted as the ship's fool. Pity the fool.
Pity the fool.
Pity the fool.
Yeah, so the crew apparently accept him at that moment all a bit easily because he got something wrong, eh? Okay.
I think because he didn't try and pretend that it wasn't his fault.
Mm-hmm.
So hence they have accepted him as the idiot. I don't know. But I guess it's like... And you do get this, you've got to think of this as rather like a playground. That's how it's being portrayed. If you are a bit of an idiot, but you kind of make that your thing, you tend to be less picked on.
Yeah, that's certainly the method I used, yes.
Yeah, so that's what he's doing. And then you've got this meeting where Cardassia is giving industrial replicators to Bajor. Everybody's like really happy and clapping apart from Kira, who's really not comfortable. And then Ducat's like, Zial's art's been accepted for an exhibition, I'm going to have a party to celebrate. And initially she's like, oh yes, I'll be there. Then you find Worf trying to teach Alexander and it doesn't go very well because he keeps going, no, not like that. And he says, fine, no, not like that, fine, because he's clearly a teenager.
Yeah.
I'm surprised.
The pair of them are just really irritating in the scene, aren't
they? They are, and he's
useless,
like,
fathering and useless teenagering. Oh, great combination.
Well, the thing is, in this, Alexander reminds me of that fucking Simpsons character whose voice is half-breaking. Do you know
Squeaky voice Dean?
Yes!
Hey! Mr. Wembley, it happened again!
That's just totally, you know, oh, sorry! Just, oh, fuck off and die. And Worf in this as well is, like, clearly uncomfortable. And you're just like, you've got the authority to tell him to fuck off. So tell him to fuck off. Or be his dad. Don't leave him to be a lemon.
Mm.
Yeah. Damar is delivering a package to Kira. Well,
there was originally the scene that was cut explained why it's Damar doing it, because there was a previous scene with Damar, Ducat and Kira, and when Damar left, Kira, Ducat proposes to assign Damar to escort Zial to the opening of her exhibit, and Kira points out that he's a self-righteous sycophant who despises everything Bajoran, and notes that Damar sneers whenever he says Bajoran, which in the scenes that's still in the story, you still see him do as well. Ducat denies it's just as Damar walks in, giving a report and sneering whenever he mentions the Bajorans. And Kira bursts out laughing. But hence, yes, I don't know why he's asked me to bring this dress. Well, it made more sense when they had that scene.
Yeah, okay, fair enough. But then Kira rejects it, and he's like, you don't like the dress? He's like, the dress is fine, I don't like you. And she properly stands up to him and tells it like it is, which I like.
Mm-hmm.
It's good. And then Zial appears. I'm like, who was that? And he's like, oh, delivery, it's addressed for you.
Slimy piece of...
he's decunt, isn't he?
Oh, dear. Yeah, I got it specially for you. It might smell slightly of Kira, just ignore that.
But they are completely different body shapes.
Yeah, I did think, that's not going to work, is it?
No, it won't fit. And then you cut to a squeaky voice teen practicing the Bat'leth, and he's so shit he keeps dropping it when he's not even fighting against anybody
it's
else.
It's just really, it's like, come on, surely they could have shown him being bad some way other than him dropping it. I mean, that's just ridiculous.
Yeah. And so Martok appears and says, why are you on this ship?
To serve the Empire, General.
That is a slogan, not an answer. Say what is in your heart.
Do you ask every new crewman this question?
I have no need to. I look in their faces and I know why they are here. They are Klingon warriors. They have answered the call of Kalis.
So have I.
Lie to yourself if you must, but not to me. You do not hear the warrior's call. I ask again, why are you here?
I'd rather not say.
What?
It's a private matter.
You're as tight-lipped as your father.
I am nothing like him.
Both stubborn, tiresome, kavatla. The only difference is I need him. I do not need you.
All I ask is a chance to prove myself.
I just gave you one, and you failed.
I love the way he says that.
Yes. And then he's like, you know, walks off of his transport, and he's like, he can't do that, it's not fair. And it's like, no, he's got every right, as your father and as your first officer. And he doesn't actually say, fuck the fuck off. Mm-hmm. But it's there in every posture, mannerism, tone of his voice. Do you know what I mean? Mm. He's just kind of, get out of my sight, I've had enough of you. He then goes and throws the dagger in the table at Worf. And Worf looks at it, and he's just got this resigned sigh of like, no, take it back. You were lucky you didn't do this to someone else, because you'd be dead. He's like, oh, you may as well kill me, because I'm 15. And then he says, Alexander's shitty, bollocky excuse that makes fuck all sense is, you haven't talked to me for 5 years, because I'm not the son you wanted, so I'm trying to become the son you wanted and being crap and making you even more cross, because that's logical.
Yeah, it doesn't quite add up, does it?
None of it adds up.
If he wanted to make his father cross, he wouldn't be back in trying to be a Klingon, because he knew that was what irritated his dad. So I don't know. I mean, they could have explained it by explaining that this was him trying to grab his father's attention. I mean, maybe that's the subtext we're supposed to read into it, but it's never made clear.
Well, so they could even have done it that, you know, he got to a stage where actually he'd been among humans for a long time and was beginning to feel out of place in the same way that Worf had.
Hmm.
Because he'd reached the age where the differences were becoming more prominent, and he having not wanted to be a warrior as a child, he had changed his mind.
Yeah.
And that would be okay if he said, no, I didn't used to. When I was a child, I didn't want to. But I've grown up, I've changed, and now I do. And that would be okay, because people do change, particularly if they go from 10 to 15. I mean, that's a lot of change, isn't it, really?
Within a couple of years, somehow.
Yeah, but you know what I mean? It's, well, I don't know. I would have thought 5 years probably have passed in real time since we last saw Alexander, actually.
Yes, because it was, what, season 7? Did he appear
in season
7?
I'm not sure he was in 7. I think
we got the alternate universe version of him, didn't we?
I think he was last in 6.
As a child, yeah. So that's, yeah, 7, and then 1, 2, 3. Yep, that's exactly right, yeah.
So he's gone from 10 to 15, roughly speaking. Mm. That you are going to change a lot. And just because he didn't want to be a warrior when he was 10 doesn't necessarily mean he's going to feel the same. I don't have an issue with the idea that the same character decides he wants to be a Klingon warrior, but that it's badly written.
Yeah, it could have been addressed and wasn't, is the bottom line. There are a million ways, well, not a million, obviously, but there are several ways they could have gone about it, but they don't seem to bother, which is weird, because presumably that's kind of an important part of the story, but it's never explained. Hey-o.
Because you can understand him going, actually, no, you know, I'm more aware now of the differences between me and humans. I want to explore my Klingon side. You're my dad. His mum's dead. His grandparents are humans. You know, I want to become a warrior now. I didn't before. I want to understand my Klingon heritage. And I want to connect with you. He doesn't have to say that necessarily is a massive info dump. He could be spread out. But that would be a legitimate, logical, sensible reason I could get behind.
Mm-hmm.
Can't get behind this at all. It's bollocks. And then there's an attack and there's a leak. So Alexander and Pigfucker go to secure it.
Apparently the ELN and the TRC are out, whatever they are. There's nothing on Memory Alpha, so we got no idea.
ELN?
Yeah, ELN and TRC. Mew.
Okay. You get some nice shots from Garen being a very good shot of weapons.
Yeah, no, it's good that she's on the weapons, isn't it? Yeah, she's played by Gabrielle Union, who went on to much bigger things.
You won't
things.
Get me, I'm part of the Union.
Really?
Sorry.
Who went on to much bigger things in Bad Boys 2 and Bring It On, apparently. Not that I've seen either of those, obviously.
We've seen Bad Boys 2.
Have we? I know we've seen Bad Boys 1. I hadn't realised we'd seen Bad Boys 2 as well.
Ah, you fell asleep.
Ah. Yeah, that's a running theme these days, isn't it?
Well, we had both had a lot of alcohol. So you've probably seen half of Bad Boys 2.
Yes.
You know, I like her as a character. And then you get Alexander has locked himself in.
Yeah.
Because he's just a twit. And then Worf just sort of puts his hand on his shoulder and suddenly everything's fine.
Yeah, locking yourself in a cupboard apparently is the solution to everything.
That's what you do.
Thing and you're accepted by everybody.
Yeah.
Including your estranged father.
Yeah, it's brilliant. That's what cupboards are for. Or something. I don't know. Fuck knows.
The Bird of Prey engine room set's not bad. It's quite small, but you kind of expect that, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Lots of smoke, obviously, but that's kind of par for the course.
Yeah. And then you get a scene back on Deep Space Nine where Zial comes up to Kira and says, you know, you weren't there. And I like this because she's honest with Zial. She says, no, I wasn't. She doesn't make any sense. No, I wasn't. And I think you know why. And Zial's like, don't ask me to choose. And he was like, no, I'm not asking you to choose. He's your father. Choose him. But I'm not being a part of this. Which I like. It's an honest scene. And I like it. And then, yeah, you've got this Worf will stand with Alexander. And you get this cheesy as fuck scene. Where he goes, I will teach you what you need to know to be a warrior. And you can teach me how to be a father.
Oh, that's fine then. Except we won't ever see any of this, so... And Alexander actually says, yeah, well, that's something along the lines of, it would be nice if you kept your word. And, well, he doesn't, blatantly, because we see Alexander
one Alexander
more time.
We see Alexander again.
Only once, one more time. And there's no sense that he's been trained or anything.
It's bollocks!
Mm-hmm.
And then you have this Martok dick thing. I don't know...
Martok dick, to do's dick, Batledek, Batledek.
It's the best kind of dick. I wonder if his is green. I somehow got the idea it's orange. I don't know why, but anyway. Or maybe multicoloured. Have you seen my dick many colours? It is red and orange and green. Oh, wow, I'd go... interesting take on Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, isn't it? That would have been showing in a theatre a little round the corner in Soho, possibly.
Wow. Yeah, and then they have this fucking ritual.
Mm.
Which, of course, involves lots of citronella candles.
Yeah, Lee would love this.
Oh, and unnecessary cutting of the hand.
Except half of it's been cut out, ironically.
Oh,
the music actually jumps. Because this is only in this country, by the way. If you're in, if you're United Statesian or elsewhere, you've got the whole thing. But in this country, when you watch it, the music actually jumps because Alexander was going to cut his hand open as well, and they decided that was showing a bad example to teenagers. Hello,
then,
dog.
And then he's in the house of Martok. But all Worf had to do is put a fucking badge on.
No. Again, originally Worf cut himself as well. So, but that got cut out. I don't know.
But all you see him do, Worf, in the episode where he joins House of Martok, is put a fucking badge on. That's it.
Oh, I see what you mean.
He took a badge and said, thank you very much, and I'll put it on my shoulder and put my badge on.
And interestingly, remember Jeremy, Wooden Boy?
Yes.
From The Bonding? He joined the House of Moog, and that just involved lighting lots of candles. Yeah. No cottage there.
So it's just like, mate, your fucking mind up. Pisses me off. And then you get, welcome to the house of Martok.
Welcome to the house of fun. Now I've come of age. Welcome to the house of fun. Welcome to the lion's den. Temptations on his way. Welcome to the house of fun.
Now you've come of age, I guess. Yes.
Yes.
Fair enough. It just amused me. I loved that song as a kid, but I had no idea what it was about. Now I know. It's like, okay.
There are some things in this episode which are worth watching.
Yeah, Martok primarily.
Martok. And the I do love a bit of Damar Snark.
Yes, that's
personally,
good.
Personally, myself.
Nice to see life on a bird of prey as well.
Bird of prey. Bird of prey.
Yes, we've done that.
But this, you know, I wasn't wrong. This episode is mostly annoying wank.
Yeah. I mean, as far as the A-plot's concerned, you get Worf and Martok accepting that Alexander is now able to function as a Klingon warrior.
Well, he's not! He's a twat!
Because he shut himself in a room. That's what proved it to them. Okay.
Are you sure it wasn't the room? Are you sure he's not Tommy Wiseau?
I don't know. And you're tearing me apart, Martok! And the Kira B-plot doesn't really go anywhere much. It feels like we've seen this from her before in the previous episode, but whereas that was about serving the Dominion and her sleepwalking into that. This is her slightly sleepwalking into becoming part of Dukat's family and then realising she doesn't want to wear that dress, thank you very much. The stakes are nowhere near as high, so it doesn't work.
Yeah.
And the ending's no ending either, it just kind of finishes.
Yeah, it's just... It's
supposed to be based on a 1950... Because all these episodes are based on either war films or westerns.
Oh, okay.
So this one's based on a John Ford film called Rio Grande.
That's one of the runabouts.
It was, yes. A Fort commander discovers one of the new recruits is his estranged son, and hilarity ensues. I mean, serious drama ensues. And this feels like it's probably a very weak source version of that, to be honest.
Oh, I don't like it.
Yeah, it's not appalling, as we've said. There is stuff that you can amuse yourself watching in it, but yeah, it's not great.
No. And Alexander is a twat.
Yes. Well, let's find out what other people thought.
Okay.
We've heard from the Mark. Sons and daughters or child soldiers? Sorry, Amory, I wanted to hate this, and it's not as good as first two outings, but it's not bad. The episode sports the return of Worf's son Alexander Rizenko, bringing up some issues concerning Worf's piss-poor parenting that had never really been put to rest back in Next Generation days. Now a teenager, Alexander has decided to enlist in the Empire's war effort. This opens some old wounds for Worf. Some may recall how Worf and Alexander were never really on the same page when it came to their respective outlooks on life, and we get a good job of using Worf and Martok as characters whom we know so well at this point. I've grown particularly fond of J.G. Hertzler's Martok, who has created a very respectable and likable personality with a commanding presence that is simultaneously three-dimensional and a true to Klingon attitudes.
Yep.
Heck, amongst non-regulars, Martok is second only to Garak. Is there a TV show with a better line on non-regular secondary characters? No, I don't think there is, actually. No. I'm going to throw Wayoon into that as well. You know?
Yes, and Damar.
Yeah. In broad terms, the writers do not give us any motivation for Alexander's about-face.
Yep.
A few heartfelt lines of dialogue probably could have made all the difference, indeed. But the absence of such dialogue really hurts the situation's believability. We had it for Nog joining Starfleet. Why would Alexander be such a physically small Klingon? Oh, wait, if we count the years from his birth, he's 10 years old, or at most he's 11 or 12. It makes one wonder just how Alexander was permitted to enlist in the first place. Is the war going so badly that the Klingons would enlist anybody willing to fight, child or not? So what about the daughters' part of Sons and Daughters, namely the renewed relationship between Dukat and his daughter Zial? Well, the ideas contained herein are certainly relevant, as Zial's presence does effectively keep the other side of Dukat in play. Dukat is about as multifaceted. There are few bad guys on TV with this level of depth. The gift Dukat sends Kira merely serves to emphasise how complex and a clever man he is, balancing sincerity and hidden motives. He presents it to Zial as if it were always meant for her. On the face of it, a nice gesture, but we know better. Look at that gift, a dress that would be like the Intendant's, a creepy villain trying to domesticate a female lead he's become enamoured with. It's more insidious this way, and, well, very Dukat. Why do I not hate this? Well, Martok's stealing every single scene he's in.
Oh, he is.
This episode saves it. Yes, this is true.
Yep. And we've heard from Doreen. Neither Alexander nor Worf come out of this episode smelling of roses.
Nope.
And the Klingon army must be in a bad way if they're accepting recruits like Alexander and just throwing them onto the front without actually training them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Or, you know, having any sort of qualifications, clearly.
Yeah.
And Sampo has this to say. This season really began with all guns blazing. Federation is at war, the stakes are high and things are grim. But now the Federation is on the offensive, and with the Kepcel White facility destroyed, I bet things will really reach new... Oh, God, it's this episode. In other words, all the momentum gained with the first two episodes comes to a screeching halt.
It does.
Alexander is a bit of a problem in general. He is so rarely mentioned that when he is featured, it's really jarring. Wolf really is a crappy father. And he's such an annoying dork in this episode. How he ever survived alive as far as the Rotaran is a complete mystery. The only reason I can think of is the war, and they'll take on everybody who wants to join. Yeah. But he is so completely and ridiculously inept that it's not even funny. He can't even hold a bat left. He cannot tell a simulation from reality, and he even locks himself into a corridor. Even Odo, disguised as a Klingon, was a better Klingon warrior.
That's true.
Speaking of that, when we last saw Alexander, he had no interest whatsoever in being a Klingon warrior. No explanation for the change of heart is given in this episode,
nope.
Which is really lazy and confusing, taking into account how completely out of his element he is.
Yep.
It all just seems totally pointless, and the resolution between Worf and Alexander at the end of the episode just seems totally bogus.
Oh, it does. It's bollocks.
And doesn't really solve anything.
No.
Sure, Worf promises to be a better father, but I really don't remember when we see Alexander again.
No.
Poor Martok. First, he has to listen to Worf bitching about the wedding, and now this. I'm guessing at this point he's hoping he'd recruited Nog instead of Worf. I was a bit disappointed we did not see any of the Rotaran crew we got to know last season. Most of them were good characters, and I would have liked to have seen them even in minor roles here. Yeah, this is true. On Deep Space Nine, we find out that Zial is quite the forgiving type, apparently forgiving his father for trying to blow her up, all her friends, and an entire solar system. Actually, when she came on the station, she was acting so wild-eyed that I thought she was trying to signal to Kira that something was wrong, but no, I guess she was genuine. I get that being half Cardassian on Beta is tough, but it seems a bit unbelievable. There is even some sort of strange relationship developing between Kira and Dukat, which seems a bit strange after last episode. I'm glad Kira got to her senses quickly, and it actually led to my favourite bit in this episode. We see that Dukat, the slimeball that he is, just gives Kira's dress to Zial after Kira threw it at him. It's so outrageous that it's funny. Ooh, I find it more creepy than anything. Yeah. So after an excellent start to the season, here the quality dips really low. Things can only get better from here. Well, hopefully they will.
Yeah. It's bad. It's not good. The only thing I think with why Zial is so forgiving of her father is she's all he's got.
Yep.
And therefore... kind of psychologically she has to be, if that makes sense.
And he's manipulative, so he shows a great kindness, and it's that horrible. I mean, if one can be grooming one's own daughter, that's effectively what he's doing. It's horrible.
It's really not nice.
And we've heard from Puri.
Hello, Orgs. Puri here, coming live from Basingstoke to talk about Sons and Daughters, hopefully my last bit of travelling for a while. This episode was actually better than I remembered. For starters, I'd completely forgotten the B-plot, which is odd, because the A-plot is basically sons and the B-plot's daughters. So the B-plot is fairly short and sweet. It's basically Dukat's a douchebag. He's basically, the whole Kira has to welcome him back onto the station every time. That's just dickish behaviour. No need for that. And yes, he's trying to get to Kira through Zial. So he's brought Zial back in the hope that Zial will... encourage them to spend time together, and through that, I'm assuming he's hoping Kira will be bought by his manliness. Indeed, there was something creepy about the dress buying scene, so it is quite good to see Kira not taking any of that crap for a second. Also Dukat's kind of, I bought you this dress. Now, the whole I bought, when Kira returned the dress and Dukat gave it to Zial, would it fit? I mean, I don't really understand how women's clothes fit, so maybe, but they are different sizes, aren't they? I suppose with Garrick not there, he can always blame the fact that the station's tailor has seriously gone downhill. The A-plot is, of course, the return of Alexander. Yep, you all demanded it. I mean, really running through these past couple of seasons with Worf back, everyone's been clamouring, when will we see Alexander? Why don't we get more Alexander? More Alexander, we demand it. Is what no one said ever. Now, that's, I think, why none of us were looking forward to this. I mean, let's face it, Alexander has not exactly been the most fascinating character. The wee shite territory he was in when he was in the cost of living? Yeah, so he comes back and he's now a moody teenager, and I mean, it wasn't bad. I did find his moody teenager stuff got a bit grumpy, a bit too far. I mean, he was somewhere between Anakin Skywalker and Kylo Ren. In fact, there was quite a lot of Kylo Ren in his I think it's the sort of slightly mumbling deep voice. You know, it's the Luke never understood me kind of thing. Except he's not very good at being a warrior. And Worf. I mean, the kind of reason they were estranged, it just seemed, because it made kind of sense for Worf to send him away. So the reason they were estranged kind of didn't really work. And I think maybe some build up to that would have been better, you know, to have a bit more aside from basically in Way of the Warrior, we heard Alexander's gone to live with his step parents, and we've not seen Hyde nor hear of him, indeed heard any word of him for the next couple of years. Until he shows up as a grumpy teenager. The plot's a bit hackneyed in that. I mean, basically, the crew bond with him a bit. Martok kills. Why has this never come up? I'm with Martok on that. I've known you, we've been in prison together, and you've never told me you had a son. I mean, seriously, right? So he doesn't know Worf that well, but surely at some point they're sitting chatting. So, Worf, any family? Kids? Wife? Is there a Mrs. Worf? And, you know, surely Worf wouldn't just go, no, he would have said, why, you know, you'd have brought up Kaelor, surely, but apparently no. Apparently, you know, when asked, he goes, or I have no idea with that. So that is a bit weird. I quite liked how Martok was actually the one who kind of thawed relations between them. It was essentially Worf and Alexander are grumpy at each other, and Martok fixes it, because Martok's brilliant. That's kind of how it pans out. Yes, I did like his bit, Martok, the caring HR man. Yes, both you and your dad are insufferable, but I need your dad, don't need you, so sod off. They bond after Alexander locks himself in a room, but does something brave. I think that was the point. And he gets to join the House of Martok. So I could finally, what I forgot to sing last time we had someone joining the House of Martok, I can now go, welcome to the House of Martok. I felt I'd missed out on that one last time. So yeah, it wasn't bad. I mean, maybe not a fantastically great episode, but actually pretty solid. And it's moving plot along as well, so there's always that. So I will be back in a bit to talk about Behind the Lines. Until then, bye for now.
Ah, another vote for House of Fun there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the B-plot doesn't tell us anything we didn't know about Ducat, let's face it. So, yeah, I don't quite understand the point of it all. But we were so clamouring for an Alexander story, weren't we?
No, everyone was not. But the thing is, the fact that Worf hasn't said anything to Martok makes you wonder what, if anything, he's told Dax?
Yes, by the way, you're going to have a stepson. One would hope that he's mentioned that.
Yeah. What did Drew and Tracy make of this one?
This is our feedback for Sons and Daughters.
Well now, go on.
So Sons and Daughters, Alexander, son of Worf, and Zia, son, daughter of...
Golda Cat.
I get it.
Yeah, sorry. This was really boring.
Yeah, I know.
I was fucking bored to tears through half of this. Obviously, Alexander is not going to be the Klingon warrior that he's trying to make out. He was brought up by Worf's adopted parents who were human?
Yes.
Yeah, so where has he got his love or his intensity for being a Klingon warrior?
Well, this was the thing, wasn't it? I mean, he didn't. If you remember back to Next Generation episodes, he wasn't interested in being a Klingon at all, was he?
I said to you through this, I said he's got abandonment issues.
Yes, yeah,
and
definitely.
And then he's abandonment!
Yeah, well, and this is the thing. This is why he's now come back with a vengeance, trying to be a proper old Klingon, isn't he? Yeah. He's like, I don't know, I guess kind of like he's now, although he wouldn't admit to himself, trying to prove that he is, you know, a proper Klingon.
Yeah, I guess. I just, at the beginning, when obviously they were in the lineup and Worf kind of clocked him, and I did say to you, whatever happened to Alexander?
Yes,
at the time?
Yes.
And then obviously it turns out that it is Alexander. And I really, when Martok said to Klingon, who was that? I really thought, please don't dish your son, or like just pretend that you don't know him. Yes. So I was glad that Worf said, that is my son.
Yes. I can understand, like, you know, like boisterous Klingons and that lot, you know, being a bit
boisterous.
But It's a little bit. There's no honour really in that. Was it his name Chitag? Was that his name?
Well, they're like, just bullies
having a fight with like someone who's obviously less experienced and younger
and
than
yeah, child.
And he was going to like maybe even kill him. I was like, there's nothing honourable about that, is there? Quite often, I think you find this with the Klingons. They're meant to be like, oh, we're so much about honour, but they don't act very honourably.
I think they were just being bullies.
Yeah, they were being bullies. Like, yes,
you know, bullying him about who he was and putting like.
Yeah.
That crap
there's
on his
there's
dinner.
Nothing honourable about any of that business,
no,
is
not
there?
At all. So Demar,
yes,
he looks like Frankenstein.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. Yeah. I can see that.
I've never really noticed it before, but when in the scene where Kira had to meet him and Goldacat from the
oh yeah
their
when
shuttle,
they got to the shuttle, yes,
I was just like, fuck me, that is Frankenstein.
Yeah,
he
can
just
see
looks
it,
really
yeah.
weird, and the attitude cut. Snide eye that he gave to Kira
oh,
when he had to go
he
give
doesn't
her the
like
dress.
Kira
he
at all, does he?
I mean, that's bleeding plain.
Yep.
So I did think at some point that yep. Alexander looked like a Klingon Davy Jones.
Yes, I know.
He just looked
he
very kind of boyish.
Says,
and
yeah. He has got a bit of a Davy Jones
pretty,
look. Pretty,
if you
yeah.
know. I mean, he looked like he had little rosy cheeks.
Yes.
So I said, oh, it's a Klingon Davy Jones.
Yep.
You know, be singing a monkey soon.
Yep.
And Goldacat. I know that he's a bastard. I know that he's a fucking asshole bastard.
yeah.
But I do think it's quite sweet how he's quite, you know, he does love Xiao now.
He does seem to, yeah.
He wanted to kill her before, but now all of a sudden she's kind of flavour of the month. But yeah. I do wonder, is he using her to get close to Kira?
Well, I guess we'll find out. I wouldn't put anything past old Goldacat.
No. Well, let's see. I'm sorry, this was a bit boring.
Yeah,
it was a
wasn't
bit vanilla.
But it wasn't yeah. the best episode.
Let's have something a bit more exciting. And yes. also, like.
Well, we've had some good, exciting ones,
yeah, but
so,
we need
you
more
know.
Of them. The Deep Space Nine crew were, like, in it for, like, all of, like, 5 seconds.
Yes,
and, like,
yeah, it's a good point, yeah.
Yeah, it was nice to see Ben and Martok having a bit of a. Bah,
yeah.
Whatever.
Bet.
But Dax and, like, Worf trying to get it on. Right, yeah. Get a room. Don't need it.
Anyhow, yeah. Not the greatest episode,
no,
but, you know.
Boring.
Oh, well.
Next one, please.
Yep.
See you later.
Bye.
Get a room. They had to be fair. It's just we were pigging in on them.
Davy Jones?
One of the monkeys.
Here we come. Walk down the street. We get the funniest looks from everyone we meet. Hey, hey, we're the monkeys, and people say we monkey around, but we're too busy singing to put anybody down.
People say we monkey
yep,
around.
All looking like Chekhov. Yeah.
Yeah. We're too busy Klingoning or something. I don't know.
Maybe not.
No. I don't see it myself. I don't
no.
see the no.
The hair isn't right for a monkey.
No.
Of either sort.
Yeah. We want the next one, don't we? Really.
Oh well, we're going to find out what the llama god made of this first.
Oh, though. From monkeys to llamas.
Well, indeed.
Llama god lark, scutik, chekchik, yayik, kuikchik. We continue season 6 with everyone's favourite character, Alexander. Oh, bollocks, it's an Alexander episode, isn't it? Actually, and I'm showing my hand a bit early here, I actually enjoy this episode a lot more than I was expecting to. Maybe it's because I'm coming down with some sort of lurgy right now, a traditional pre-Christmas flu, yay. So maybe that's warped my judgment slightly, but yeah, it wasn't too bad. And thanks to the lurgy, you'll be spared the spectacle of my trying to sing at you again, so, you know, at least this is good for someone. So to look at the two threads separately, I mean, because there's two threads in this episode, there's the Alexander thread and the Xiao thread, and I think the first question the episode poses is Rutaran the Klingon word for Enterprise, given they're the only ship in the sector that can possibly help out, etc, etc, etc. So, but yeah, no, it's a great episode in that we get to follow Martok and his crew, although I've got to say Bashir's really quite grumpy and that he doesn't like Klingon singing. It's glorious! Of course it's glorious. That's what Klingon's all about. I think I'd quite enjoy that, singing with every mission, although, yeah, given what you all had to put up with recently, I don't think really the rest of my crewmates would, so yeah, I guess it prevents being stabbed in the back. Having a quick look at my notes, I did notice that I asked whether they'd actually cut a bit off a regular one, but that question's already been answered by your good selves in the previous podcast, which I only just listened to this very evening, actually, in between watching the episode and recording this feedback, so yeah, it is the modified model, so there you go, that answers that question. Who says you're not informative? No one, actually. Never mind. So yeah, I mean, the whole Alexander subplot is Alexander proving himself, and And yeah, I guess it's a little bit predictable. There is a very strange question as to why Alexander has suddenly gone full-on Klingon. But, you know, it could be a lot worse. Although he is, at points, wily enough to be a Skywalker. Yeah, okay, I've just seen Star Wars. I'm not gonna... That's the main thing on my mind at the moment. Although he is, you know, that whiny, at least he's trying. He's being his own man. And I was quite surprised at the end that it wasn't the case that his crewmates were trying to off him. Because that would have been your typical Worf steps in to protect him sort of plot. But no, it was Alexander's finding his own route, his own way of what it means to be Klingon. And much the same way his father is. So yeah, on the whole, I don't think it was really all that bad. And the episode ends with a proper Klingon ceremony stuff with candles, and that's good. Good, nice and aromatic. Relaxing bubble bath after that. No, I'm thinking of the Locks on Troy episode, aren't I? Different episode. Alexander finds his way to be useful and, yeah, joins the House of Martok, so that's quite nice. The only question is, of course, that Worf says, "I will stand by you, Alexander." But will we actually ever see him again? I'm not sure we do. So yeah, there we go. Worf's still a shit dad. Never mind. In contrast, I think, despite what I said, I think I still enjoyed the Zial Dukat Kira stuff. It's great that they brought her back, really, because she is a good way of getting more conflict out of Kira and Dukat, and obviously when those characters are sparking off each other, they are fantastic. But Zial's presence gives them a much more nuanced conflict, because it's not just two enemies, but it's two enemies with a shared common interest, and someone who's a really sweet girl, so yeah, I like that. Although, obviously, Zial is, you know, also quite naive as well, expecting them to just get on happily, so yeah, there's a lot of things that are going to go badly now that she's back on the station, I imagine. But it'll be interesting to see how it plays out over time, especially as, no spoilers, but, you know, Kira is starting to act as more of an adjutant against the Cardassians, so it'll be interesting to see how this turns out when Zial's loyalty is torn. So, yeah, no, it was an interesting setup on the station, and always, as I say, always good to see Dukat and Kira sparring, so, yeah. So I think between that and just Klingon stuff, good Klingon stuff being good Klingons, I think that kind of really outweighed the Alexander being a whiny little shit side of things. So, yeah. On the whole, this wasn't too bad. With the only other positive point being that they're still using the bad guy's theme tune for Deep Space Nine, the old Cylon-based Star doorbell. So, yeah, I'm glad they're still using that. So, yeah, let's hope they keep using it through the next episode. So, yeah, it's okay. So the next episode is not going to be an Alexander episode. So let's see what it is.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I don't know. Are you getting the sense that the Rotaran is the only Klingon ship in the galaxy?
It has featured a few times, hasn't it?
It has.
It's still a bit of a mystery why Martok has only got a bird of prey and not a vulture.
Because I get the impression that it's like the Rotaran is the expendable ship. So, because he says, you know, he can't spare any more ships. In other words, he's not a very good ship. But surely by now, Garon would have put Martok on a better fucking ship.
You'd have thought.
You would have thought, wouldn't you?
But yes, I guess this is always going to score fairly highly with Lama because he does like his Klingon, so there we are.
Yeah, but so do I, but not Alexander.
Let's move on to Behind the Line, shall we?
That's a good idea.
Bonded by loyalty.
I need you, Odo. The Resistance needs you.
United by war.
We will fight until we can't fight anymore.
Now, face to face with the enemy.
If only you had stayed with us, Odo.
Will Odo turn his back on his people?
You belong with your own kind.
Or betray the Federation?
You just handed the Alpha Quadrant to the Dominion.
On the next Star Trek Deep Space Nine.
Another one of those really clever trailers that drops a big spoiler in there. Will Odo betray the Federation? You just handed the Alpha Quadrant over to the Dominion. Well, yeah. I guess the answer is yes then. Well done. Dull. We open with a lovely shot of Starbase 375 surrounded by Federation ships. Yeah, and every time we see it, it seems to have more and more ships as well, which is really cool.
Yes, it's cool.
In the Defiant's mess hall, Nolka's sourced some Saurian brandy for the Defiant officers.
No, I like this because he says he might be a cadet, but he's still a Ferengi.
Yeah, it makes him sound a bit like a racketeer, it has to be said, but there we are. And we have the liturgy of the used-up phaser power cell, which is a nice prop, I suppose. And then Admiral Ross arrives and he's finally wearing the right uniform! Woohoo! Excellent stuff. Looks far better. He brings news that Starfleet Intel has discovered an array that the Dominion have been using to monitor all their ship movements, and Sisko's mission is to take it out. Meanwhile, on Terak Nor, Kira and Roma are spying on Damar in Quarks. He's lost a pad that had details of the deep doo-doo they're in over the shortage of white. The plan is to poison the last of the supplies so that it won't face crazed Jemadar, but Rom has passed the pad on to the Jemadar, cunning little Ferengi.
Yes.
Eckhart gets thrown over the bar in the ensuing rumble. Yeah. That's great, that is.
I like that. But I like this as well, because Rom, he said in the beginning, you know, hello, I'm a spy, and you think, yeah, you're going to do a good job. But like, he does, though, yeah. Doesn't he?
He's improved his technique somewhat, hasn't
he? Yeah.
At one point, one of the Cardassians gets their back broken.
Oh, I know, there's a nasty sound effect, isn't it?
Ooh, that's going to hurt.
But one thing I noticed is that when they're fighting and that, even when they've got knives, the Kardashians don't go for the tubes of white.
No.
Which surprised me. Because I mean, if you've only got your fists and that, you're not going to do that. You're going to be lamping someone. I get that. But if you've got a knife, at least one of them seemed to have an opportunity and not take it.
Ah, well. T'Kat starts arguing with Wayun about the how the fight came about, but the Vorta counsels him to show a united front. Smile and wave, boys. Smile and wave. And you get a nice rictus grin from Alamo.
Yeah. I am smiling.
Sisko's plan is to go through the Argolis cluster, with all its long queues for the tills and waiting for the goodies to arrive on the conveyor belt of joy. This really isn't going to work for you non-UK types, is it? But never mind.
It's not going to work for me, to be honest, in a way, as somebody who had a Saturday job in Argos over Christmas one year.
Yes, wasn't that one time you turned up for work with sick in your hair?
Yeah. Yeah, I had a few drinks with a friend and stayed the night at hers and got up early in the morning to get the bus to go into work. And I didn't know many people there, but I did know one who was acquaintance more than a friend, but we got on well from school. But he waited typically till right at the end of my shift until he went, yeah, did you know you got sick in your hair?
Nice friend.
Yeah, and I'd been serving customers the whole day.
Oh, well, at least the Defiant won't be short of little pens for a while anyway.
And they never worked. Don't you remember? They used to go to write and they would disappear inside the thing, wouldn't they?
Yeah, so the little pads were tissue paper, weren't they?
Oh,
apparently Dax's science skills will get them through or something. Odo is cheesed off that Kira went ahead with the plan despite his objections. And Rene does cheesed off really well, let's face it.
But I like this. He clearly expects to be in charge, doesn't he? He expects to be obeyed.
Yeah.
And the idea... And he left the meeting.
Yeah, his fault.
Yeah. And it's like, we decided to do it because you fucked off. And he went, you went again behind my back. No, you fucked off.
Yeah. And his problem is that he's a council member charged with keeping order as well as a resistance member. And just when it looks like things couldn't get any more conflicted for him, the Alpha Founder arrives. Oh, good. The Alpha is antsy because she's been stuck with solids too long. Dear. Oh. More prunes, maybe.
X-lax, yeah.
She's looking to Odo for liquid company.
Oh.
To the bar! Ross wants to promote Sisko to being his adjutant, meaning Dax will command the Defiant on the mission to Argos. It would appear that this does involve a jump in rank, though, as the previous adjutant was a captain as well. And Sisko would have ended up being a Commodore otherwise, which would have been a bit weird, our first Commodore main character in Star Trek. And Commodores haven't been a thing since the original series, let's face it. They were always baddies. They were the Badmirals back in the day.
Yeah.
The Alpha enters the wardroom on Deep Space Nine, and Coombs does a great job of showing his diffidence to her, not meeting her eyes. Whereas T'Kat is predictably all swagger and hot air.
Yeah.
It's immediately deflated because the minefield's still there. And we get an amusing trouser battle between T'Kat and Wayun as to who's winning the war.
I like that. And I like that as well, the way she turns around to Odo and she says, are they always like that?
Yeah.
And
he's
like,
yeah. Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Odo admits to missing the link and the Alpha sees his love for Kira. He's not happy with his feelings for her and the Alpha offers him clarity through linking sexy times. Now, there's some debate between the showmakers as to whether that's what's going on with the link, but Rene definitely plays it as a sexual thing, doesn't he? And I believe that was LeVar Burton's intention in directing it as well. So,
did LeVar Burton direct this?
He did, yes.
See, I've always... Bear in mind I have seen the whole thing all the way through, and that therefore might affect how I'm reading these scenes now. But I've always seen it as, with changelings, yes, it is a form of intimacy, which therefore in some ways is going to be sexual, but there is an extent to which you can't draw a parallel because it's a bit like the drop in the ocean drop thing. It's it would be like, basically, I know there's only two of them in this instance, but ordinarily there's loads of them.
Yes.
Isn't there?
Yes.
And then one of them becomes many and many become one, mm-hmm. kind of.
But ultimately, when the actor says that's the way he's playing it.
No. How can I put it? I guess you're supposed to read it in a way that he's cheating on Kira.
Mm-hmm.
But I think there's, because it's part of their species and part of how they are supposed to be, to me, there's an extent to which it's not analogous. So I'm not saying there isn't a sexual element, but it's more than that and not quite the same as that.
Kira is surprised to find Damar manning the security office in place of Odo. She goes to see him in his quarters and is furious to discover he'd linked with the Alpha, worrying about the leaking of the resistance plans.
Which I understand, because that's how Odo knew about Gowron, but it wasn't Gowron.
Exactly. And confusing, he claims that you don't share things in the link, but then goes on to say that she can't hide anything from him in the link, which seems a bit contrary, really.
I don't know. I think he seems to be saying you can't hide motivation, I think. But then she'd still pick that up, wouldn't she?
Mm. Yeah, he's still part of the Resistance, so his motivation isn't exactly pure as driven snow.
See, the thing is, this whole thing, I read it as the Alpha grooming him.
Mm.
And he is being abused and he doesn't spot it. He doesn't see that's what's happening.
He's certainly being very naive, because he claims that he's trying to persuade her that the Federation isn't a threat.
Yeah, but But then he is naive, because we already know it's been established that for a changeling, he is very young. The Alpha is grooming him. And the Alpha is abusing him, and the Alpha is manipulating him.
O'Brien teaches Nog about the senior officer at the con being called Captain Thing, that's come up before, which you'd have thought he'd have learnt from the Academy already, but I guess he's only had a year in the Academy,
yeah.
hasn't he? And now he's already out on
placement.
Yeah. Having had a last look round the bridge, Sisko watches the Defiant depart from his office, which is a lovely effect shot.
Yeah.
He's got a very worried look on his face, and thanks to earlier dialogue, we're not sure if that's because he's worried he won't see his crew again, or he's worried he won't see his ship again.
Yeah.
Damar's celebrating in Quark's because he's been promoted. He's no longer Glynn, but now he's a gull himself. Quark gets him drunk to learn why and staggers into the Resistance meeting off his face, thanks to drinking a bottle of Canard with Damar.
I love that. Yeah. It's chock-a-block, isn't it?
It is really, isn't it? Yes. He reckons life under the occupation is no fun, and it's a great performance by Shimmer.
I love it.
Apparently Damar has solved the problem of the mines. Bam, bam, bam. It's decided Odo will disable the thingamy that will set off alarms when Rom has to do the tinkety-tonk to the thingamy to put a stop to Damar's plan or something. It did get a bit technobabbly at that point.
But you understood what Odo had to do.
Yes, he had a job to do, and he doesn't do it. But never mind. Meanwhile, Worf is stressing over Dax having been gone so long, and reckons Sisko is more stressed about his ship as well.
Yeah.
Ross points out that Sisko needs to sleep, otherwise the Bolian operation he's planning will go to poo. A polling operation? Blimey.
Oh, you see, it's all about the jazzle.
And the haircuts, yeah. Sisko says there's no way he's going to sleep anyway. The Alpha is explaining more about the link to Odo, saying sometimes she just likes to be a tree. And she talks him into linking to learn more. As a result, Rom sets off the alarms, and originally, apparently, Odo would have become so involved with the Alpha changing that he actively turned against the Resistance, arresting Rom himself. But rather than risk making him seem completely unlikable, they instead go for this sort of sin of omission, effectively. He's not concentrating when he should be.
Well, it's more than that, though, because when she confronts him, he actually says...
Well, he says why he wasn't concentrating, that it didn't matter.
He says, he says... And nothing else
matters. The Defiant returns after a successful mission that we don't see. Abu wanted to see Dax in command.
I did, and shooting shit and all the
rest
of it.
Yeah, I'm going to sulk now. She does get to do the Liturgy of the Phaser thingy, though. So yes. That's something. And Sisko takes a wistful look around the mess before leaving for more admin. Lucky him!
Yeah.
Kira's on the warpath, belting the locking mechanism in Odo's room.
I like that.
And maybe she didn't damage the set. Odo comes across as a sort of, distracted, like he's stoned or something.
Yeah, he does! Stoned is a good way of describing
it. It's like, not my problem, man, I'm bothered. Oh. Odd ending, but that's because, of course, it's not an ending, because it's just going to go straight into the next chapter in the arc.
The thing is, all this stuff, all the dialogue between Odo and the other changeling. You get that he's asking a load of questions, whatever, and then she just—it just totally reminded me of this morning with Richard, not Judy.
Right?
Do you remember they used to do the Jesus sketches?
Yeah.
Where someone would say something, and then Jesus would say something. It wouldn't make any sense at all. And one of the disciples would ask a question, and the answer would be, "But that's just the whole thing." That it was the ocean. Becomes a drop. And it's just, that's totally where my brain went, was this morning with Richard, not Judy. But
Okay, right.
Sorry.
It was originally going to be called Life During Wartime, and based on another film, 1930 Howard Hawks film this time, The Dawn Patrol, about a reluctant commander having to send young recruits into war, which basically is just the tiny, you know, the Cisco B plot, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
Only a very small part of it. At one time, the script featured Dax getting addicted to battle, and she would sort of become a sort of General Patton type figure. But we don't see any of that either, sadly.
And in one way, it would fit with her character, because that's why she's attracted to Klingons, isn't
exactly.
it? Because she's got that aspect to her.
So in some ways, I rather wish they'd reversed the plots and we'd actually seen the mission,
yeah,
and that had become the A-plot, and then had the stuff with fewer scenes with Odo and the Alpha, because they do drag a bit, actually. But still, I mean, obviously, the bit at the end when Ron gets arrested is all very dramatic and fun. I like that. It's just, yeah, I'm not so sure we're so bothered about the link at this stage. It's like, slows it down a bit, doesn't it?
It does. I mean, on the one hand, I get it, because we know how manipulative they are, and the Alpha is clearly manipulating Odo, and he doesn't understand that he's being groomed. He doesn't understand that that's what's happening to him, and Kira can see it. But at the same time, by saying to him, you mustn't link, she's denying him part of his essence, mm-hmm. of who he is as a being, and that is not a reasonable demand for her to make of him, actually.
Although she could rightly argue, now is not the time. I mean, yes, feel free to do that, but not when we're in the middle of a war.
Which is what she says, but he's been deprived of a key aspect of his very being,
mm-hmm.
and now the opportunity's there, she's saying you're not allowed to do that. And I'm not sure, I don't think she's being deliberate, but I don't think she understands that what she's asking isn't reasonable.
What do other people think?
Oh, we've heard from Sampo. He writes, well, this is clearly an improvement compared to the last episode, even though it's not quite as good as the first two.
Yeah, I think that's, I completely agree with that assessment. Yeah.
The Cisco storyline is nice. It's a small piece on the things you need to let go when gaining more responsibility. We as the viewers are promised some action as the Defiant sets off to destroy a Dominion sensor array, but we don't actually get to see it.
Yes.
He says, I don't really feel cheated. Now we as the viewer can feel what Cisco is feeling, frustration at being left out of the action.
I guess that's rather the point, but I'd still rather see the action.
I do still feel cheated, yeah. He says, all in all, the bits with Cisco work really well, and Admiral Ross continues to be the best Starfleet Admiral we've seen so far. On the station, the Resistance finally does something as they incite a fight between the Cardassians and the Jem'Hadar, and it's nice to see that the Ketracel White raid actually had some effect. But Odo isn't happy because they caused disorder on his station. I'm not really sure what he expected the Resistance to do, but at least it's in keeping with his character. He gets something else to think about when the female changeling arrives on the station. I'm a bit torn about Odo in this episode. On the other hand, I do understand the need to learn about his people and all that, but while he's chatting idly about turning into rocks and clouds and changelings being one and many, all I can think about is that other person is a tyrant, directly responsible for the deaths of thousands, if not millions, of Federation citizens, and I think Odo should have kept his distance from the beginning. Mm. The Alpha is the only other one of his kind, and he is still, in their eyes, a child. /teen. He's very young, isn't he, Odo, in their eyes, for their species.
Well, it's not that he's young, but he's not experienced the link.
No.
And, yeah, he's been out of touch.
And it's... I don't... there's a very large extent to which I don't think that Odo can help it, and I also think that that's the entire bloody point of the Alpha turning up on the station.
Could be. We shall see.
And he continues, the episode is a bit twofold. I like the Cisco stuff as well as the Resistance stuff, but the scenes between the two changelings really start to drag, which I didn't mm-hmm. find, but you did.
Yeah.
All in all, I mostly like this one. Miles better than the last one anyway. As a final note, I'd like to wish you a Merry Christmas.
Oh, thank you.
And maybe not a Happy New Year yet, because I'll guess you'll be recording before the year is out.
We will.
We will.
Dorian says, I'm beginning to hate the female changeling almost as much as Kai Winge. Poor Odo is being manipulated by everyone in this episode. Why are people who are trying to tell other people that their friends aren't suitable such hypocrites?
Mm.
I liked how and when Quark becomes part of the Resistance.
Yeah,
yes.
I loved it.
Jake was better in this episode. I wasn't as moved by the power cell ritual when Dax was in charge of it. Her voice isn't as commanding as Sisko's. I really, really liked seeing Starbase 375 at the beginning and seeing how very different Deep Space Nine is from the Federation space stations. You do get that contrast, yeah.
Yeah, you do.
Thank you, Doreen.
Thank you. In terms of Dax not being as commanding, I kind of think that's the point.
Mm-hmm.
That she's done well with the mission and everything. She's not rubbish, but she isn't Sisko. And I kind of think that's also part of the point that you as the viewer are supposed to take away.
All right.
That's what I thought. Because I also thought she didn't... I didn't think she used exactly the same words. And I also don't think she didn't use the same gestures. It was different when she did it. And in a way, that makes sense because every captain is different, aren't they? The way they command is different. But I kind of felt that she's good enough, but part of the reason that Sisko is feeling that pang and that pull is because actually, even though he knows she's good enough, she isn't actually as good as him.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Maybe.
More sense than the last time I was a bit rambly. And we've heard from the Mark. And he writes, behind the lines, or I didn't forget, it just didn't seem to matter. I love Angry Kira from afar, but I would not want to be close to Angry Kira in real life. I'm with you on that. When Quark shows up to Kira's Resistance meeting drunk, and with the crucial information that Damara's a plan for deactivating the minefield, we see a barkeep who's genuinely sick of the occupation. He's become too accustomed to the Federation presence and he wants it back. He doesn't like the Cardassians anymore, they're mean and arrogant, and he can't stand the Jem'Hadar, for obvious reasons. It's refreshing to see Quark take a side. And just as Quark seems finally to be coming around into usefulness, we see Kira losing her grip on a person much more vital to her cause, namely Odo, who finds his priorities completely shattered when the Alpha Changeling comes to him to offer insight into the Great Link so that he might learn more about himself. I mean, that's the thing. I mean, it must be... The Alpha Changeling isn't turning up and asking him to pick a side. The Alpha Changeling is not being that obvious. The Alpha Changeling is distracting Odo from what he might be doing to thwart the Dominion's plans by telling him more about himself, which it knows Odo wants to know. The Alpha Changeling is very clever.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting. He says that to say Kira's worried would be an understatement. When she finds out Odo has linked with the other shapeshifter, she's angry and extremely frustrated. Her reaction is less of a friend and more of a cheated-on lover.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think that's true. I think, yeah.
Well, certainly that sense of betrayal there, isn't there?
There is, yes. The effectiveness of the story's dramatic irony I attribute to René Auberjonois's striking change in the way he performs Odo. Before linking, he's the Odo we know, aggressive, passionate and forceful when he speaks his mind. But after linking, he's reserved, indifferent and quiet. He just doesn't seem to care because his life has suddenly gone in a new direction. This new direction is interesting in itself as it toys with the possibilities of the changeling's existence. The ending is brave because it takes some real chances. Not only does it bury the Federation's chances in the war even deeper under apparent hopelessness, it completely changes Odo's attitudes and his relationship with Kira. What's more, he doesn't even seem to care what he's caused by his inaction. He now sees it as none of his concern because he's a changeling, understanding his own people more and Solids less. I don't see how Kira could ever trust Odo again. I wouldn't. And the Alpha Changeling knows about the rebellion and doesn't give a single fuck. Her goal is Odo, and the universe could burn and it wouldn't seem to matter. And when Sisko is taken off the front line, being assigned to a desk job in charge of an entire wing, it highlights the bond between Sisko and the crew of the Defiant, which he must sever in the interests of larger duties. These are the little details that make the war arc feel epic in scope.
Hmm. Is this true? Thank you, sir.
Thank you. What did the Lama God make of this one?
Lama God's Lark, supplemental. We finally discover what it is that Jadzia Dax does whilst walks away. The episode starts when O'Brien discovers her Klingon pleasure stick. Or at least I'm assuming that's what he's carrying into the mess hall is. I don't know, maybe he should have washed it first. Oh, who knows? Anyway. But everybody seems to be quite entertained by it, so yeah, I guess the crew that fights together uses pleasure sticks together. I'm sorry, I don't know where I'm going with any of this. My first question in this bit of feedback, given what I just a couple of minutes ago, because obviously I was reading ahead in my notes, I wasn't. If it is a new model, a regular one, did they also build a CG model of to use in the Starbase? Because that looked base CG-ish. Also, just a really good model shot in the close-up we get at one point in the episode. We're zooming in on the Admiral's office. This is a very unimportant point, so I'll just leave it there, but it was interesting. So, yeah, as I said just a few minutes ago, Kira is finally, and the Resistance, they're finally starting to strike back at the First Order. No, sorry, wrong show again. Kira the Resistance are finally starting to destabilize things on the station, causing a barbell, so that's interesting. We also find out that Rom is good with his hands. Oh, yeah. Now we know why it is that Lisa married him. Frankie, who's good with his hands, is... Frankie, who's good with his hands? I don't know where to go with that, really, to be honest. Dax and Akuru being sent off to the Valamagudis cluster. So, did we hear about the Argolis cluster before? No, I'm not sure. It could have been. There's lots of clusters and lots of listening posts, but I'm sure they've used the Argolis system before and stuff. Again, I could look it up because I'm at the computer right now, but I'm not going to. I'm going to make you answer it instead because it's Christmas. Something like that. And so, yeah, there's, again, two strands to this episode now, and I think I'm not sure how the rest of the season is going to go, but obviously we've got one strand of the Federation, one strand of what's happening in Deep Space Nine. So the stuff with the Federation is a slightly slighter tale this time. It's just Ben's anxieties about having to not be in the battle when Dax and Co. go out. And it's interesting that that he's obviously really having a hard time with being left behind, because it's not just that he wants to be in the fight, but it's people that he cares about. So it's interesting to see. But obviously they came back okay. Or is it obvious, because there is some jeopardy here? But yeah, they came back okay, but it was also really sad to see that Ben was left out of his own party that he, well, assuming he set up that tradition of honouring the pleasure stick, whatever it is, that he wasn't really in place at his own party. So that was quite sad to see. Obviously, Sisko needed a conversation with Captain Kirk in the Nexus. That's what kept him in the seat of the action and driving June buggies. That's exactly what every captain should have. But yeah, no, the Sisko Defiant crew side of things was a nice, entertaining plot, although I'd have liked to have seen them actually attacking the Argolis cluster, but yeah, fine, I guess we're going to see that hopefully they're saving the money for a big battle coming up later. Meanwhile, back on the station, we find out that when Odo finally gets a shag, he's a shit. The return of Constable Wet Patch is not a good wet patch this time. I'm not sure there is such a thing as a good wet patch, but anyway. So yeah, the female founder, I can't remember what you nicknamed her before, so I'm looking forward to seeing what you call her. But salam to her. Yeah, she turns up and is obviously trying to seduce Odo, or just because, she's lonely and needs the company of another. Despite Kira trying to convince Odo that maybe in the middle of a stressful situation, now's not the time to be investigating his emotion ship, Odo just can't give in. He's a bit helpless. I mean, yeah, you could say that he's relatively young and naive, at least as far as one of his people goes, but thanks to his inability to resist, Odo has gone and done fucked up this time, and Rom is in the ship. And we've seen from the various flashback episodes about basically how well that sort of thing goes when the Cardassians capture people who are acting against them. I mean, so this has already driven a wedge between Kira and Odo, and it's chilling, really, to see how Odo doesn't give a damn. It's, I guess, what's an interesting parallel would be between the Great Link and the Borg, that they're all shared consciousnesses. They've got a hive mind. It's kind of interesting to discover that, the whole drop becoming the ocean becoming the drop kind of thing. And in a similar way, Odo stops caring about things when he links with them. So this is clearly not a good thing. He should be happy with him that he's going to reunite with at least one of his people, but nope, because they're evil and they just don't care. And this is not a good thing. This is not going to go well. And I can't imagine Kira and Odo becoming a thing at any point in the future. So yeah, never mind. But that said, yeah, Odo may have been a git, but surely alarm bells should have been ringing when it was Demar who said that he's found a way to get rid of the cloaked Federation minds, because, I mean, come on, it's Demar. Okay, fair enough, we all thought the Rom wasn't the smartest tool in the box, and he came up with the idea, so, maybe, but still. They should have smelt a bit of a bowl at that point, so, yeah, I don't think they're all to blame for falling into that obvious trap. Oh well, they could have done without Odo losing his mind when he gets distracted and gets his gooey end away, so, this is clearly a very tense pace, and I'm slightly scared to see where this goes next. Even though, okay, yeah, actually, I know how it turns out, but all the same, this is really tense stuff, and it is great so far. So, yes, Not sure when we'll be watching the episodes next, because obviously it's in we're taking a Christmas break, I'm assuming, or something? Or do we get to watch Star Trek 3 soon? Who knows? I guess we'll find out soon enough. But yes, given it is that time of year, I'll be merciful and not leave you with a song, and I'll just wish a glorious Christmas to you all, and to all your houses, a good night.
Scariest Santa ever.
Yeah. But thank you. Actually, you're right. DeMar coming up with the idea, it doesn't really work.
Yeah, we don't really know enough about him to say one way or the other, I guess. But yes, it's never been stated he's been a particular technical bod before now, but there we are. Yeah, I think the space station they are model effects, because they talked about getting the model out and altering it a bit from its days as the office complex. And you're probably thinking of the Argos Array, which I think was the Argos Array.
I think it was the Argus Array.
Argus, that's it. Yeah, the Argus Array from Next Generation, which was another thing. But not the name of the system it was in either. So, as for Christmas plans, well, more about that a bit later on. But Drew and Tracy, did they like this one a bit better, hopefully?
So we've just watched Behind the Lines.
We did.
That was a right good one, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was good, actually.
And I'm
jumping
right to, like, the...
Yeah, that's fine. It's enjoyable stuff. A lot better than the last one.
Oh, yeah. Right at the beginning.
Yeah.
Kira and Rom.
Yes.
Are doing a bit of what I labelled shit-stirring.
It's your favourite phase, isn't it?
In Quark's bar.
Yeah.
Sort of saying, oh, you know, we've given them...
Calls in dissent.
Yeah. And then all hell broke loose, which is kind of what they wanted. And then people got hurt, and then people died. Quark got thrown over the bar and stuff like that. And I just thought, well... Is it right that they do that? They're shit stirring.
Well, you don't make an omelette without breaking some eggs.
Well, I know, but what if, like, Quark had been killed or something like that? Would it have been worth it in the name of just a little bit of a shit stirring?
I don't know. It's just causing dissent.
Jaco has not changed his clothes in the whole of this season so far, I don't think.
Apart the sixth part.
He's been wearing his, like, Oliver
really?
And Twist clothes,
I've not noticed.
Come on now.
Change clothes.
Yeah, it's not like you're not living
his
in your own...
His dad's not there anymore,
exactly.
Saying, come on, son.
Yeah, but
them clothes be walking around on their own, so you don't change them.
But he doesn't live with his dad, does he? He lives
good point.
What's his chops?
Nog. Well, I guess Nog's not saying to him, come on.
No, but he must reek by now.
Fair
He's
enough.
Been living in them for about 3 weeks. So the resistance of 4.
Yes.
Really?
Well, you know, that's the resistance
isn't it?
Yeah, it's good. I liked it. And when... Quark went in, he's drunk, he's helping him out. I thought it was good.
It was so funny. So funny.
Yeah, it's good.
What's the female changing name? I just call her...
Well, she hasn't got a name, did she? Right. She did say, yeah, oh, I haven't got a name. You know, what's the point
Why
of a name?
Why do I need a name?
Yeah. Exactly.
So, all right then. Changeling found a woman face. She
was
weird, isn't she?
Yeah, I guess
really
she is.
She's really freaky. She's like, oh, we don't... You know, when we... change shape, we turn into trees and we turn into clouds. So basically they're fucking hippies, or she's a hippie.
I don't know about that.
To be fair.
But I tell you one thing though, I'd say, you know, all the way through this, the changelings, they want Odo back, don't they?
Mm.
You know, and I was just thinking, like, he's just like one person. It's like, you know, if you thought of him like as like someone like someone from the UK or something, like everyone wouldn't be like, oh, we must get him back, you know. They're like really seem to care about Odo, don't they? They could just say, oh, he's not one of us, let's just ignore him.
But there's an ulterior motive going on.
Well, this is what I was thinking. You know, they was continually saying, we want you back, come back, you don't belong to the solids and that lot. And at first of all, I was thinking, oh, they really care. But now, after this episode where she's linking with him, and especially at the end where she comes out and it's all been a trick, I'm just thinking, like, do they care about him, or is this just all a plan?
They don't. Because, and I'll tell you for why, she's like, when he says, oh, how many are you? We are one, but we are many. When we first saw the changelings and they were on that planet and they came out of the pool, there was about 3 of them, wasn't there?
Yeah.
Yeah. So where the fuck are the other 2? Has she absorbed them? Has she eaten
them? Well,
she's
just saying that when they're in the link, they're just all merged in together, aren't they?
No. So why did 3 come out then? Why is she not travelling with, like, more people?
But there might be some more, I don't know. But I'm just talking about the ulterior motives.
Oh, she's just
I just think, like, now, after the end of it, like, the twist, that Odo's basically become complicit with them and...
No, she's just bending his mind.
And she now knows about the resistance and all that, like, doesn't she?
Does she,
though? Well, yeah, because...
But Odo said it wasn't about sharing information.
Yeah, but Kira was saying, like, you know, we's relying on you and all that. Like, they must know what's going on. I don't know what's going on with it all now.
I just think she's kind of luring him into kind of some false orgasmic state to kind of take him into the link. Because he's like, it's so good. Mm. You know, he's obviously getting
and then just turns
some weirdness out of it. So this, for me, was a lot of fucking shit-stirring going on. It was just like Kira and Ram and Damar, a little bit of shit-stirring going on. And then Mrs. Changeface.
Yeah.
You know, loads of shit stirring
going
on.
Lots of twists and turns.
Mm.
But it's a good episode, eh?
Very good episode. I'm not quite sure I'd buy Dax as a captain. No, I don't buy it. And Ben, let it go.
He's got to let it go. Don't start singing.
But
that
you know
song.
He's never going to let it go, and he's going to be back on the Defiant soon as.
But good stuff, and looking forward to the
enjoyed
next.
Enjoyed that one.
Yep.
Let's have a next one.
Okay.
See you later. Bye.
Bye. Thanks, guys. Mrs. Changeface. The whole thing is that, you know, Odo's part of the ocean, that's why they want him back, because they're not quite complete without him.
Okay.
And the galaxy's most violent hippie. Eventually she would be, wouldn't she? Not sure you
that's a bit like me when I was trying to be a hippie when I was about 15 or 16.
Oh yeah, you were a militant hippie, weren't you?
Well, basically, me and my sister did not get on when I was that age. And I remember I had all my Joss sticks going and I can't remember what the fuck I was listening to. And she came into my room and I couldn't stand her. And I just shouted out to my voice, fuck off! I'm fucking meditating! I wasn't a very good hippie, I wasn't overly successful. Yeah. I hadn't noticed that Jake hadn't changed his clothes.
No, I hadn't noticed that either. I mean, all his clothes are equally awful, so I just assumed it was different ones, but yeah, okay, oh dear.
Yeah.
He must be honking.
But in terms of them wanting Odo back, if they are a true gestalt, they will be diminished by his absence.
Exactly. Okay, and finally, Pie Man.
Hello again, Parry here to talk about Behind the Lines. Now, this one was quite interesting because you initially think... I mean, I like the little ritual that they showed that had started from the Defiant. Again, we get an idea that time's passed and that the crew are developing rituals and, you know, they're definitely now kind of a warship crew. And I quite like that idea that, you know, yes, they've got a little sort of phaser, really, or phaser power pack ritual whenever one runs out or goes bad or something. Although, then just propped up against the wall, we've seen the Defiant take some big hits and kind of everything go flying. I hope no one's in the mess hall when that happens, because those things are a hazard. You know, bolt them down, restrain them, put them in a rack, something like that. But, you know, their health and safety nightmare is really what I'm getting at. So there is a sort of planned mission, and initially this is what you think the episode is going to be about, that we're going to be seeing this mission to, I think it was Argolis, to take a sort of relay station, but in fact it turns out it's not. It's actually about the rest of the crew being sent off and Sisko staying at home, and we stay with Sisko. Part of me was kind of annoyed because I'd have really liked seeing that Argolis thing. It sounded quite exciting, but I do like the character idea, the fact that Sisko is having to do a bit more of, quite frankly, admiraling. You know, he's Ross's adjunct. Ross's buddy, and he's having to work a lot on strategy, and so as a result, command quite rightly goes to Dax, which is really neat. And I did like the clarification by O'Brien that yes, you call whoever's in the centre seat captain, and the wee joke with Nog that you know, by the time you're captain, there'll be no one to call you. Now, but the main action's actually in the station. So, if I was to tastelessly summarise this plot, I would say the female changeling has been around Solace too long and really fancies a Link. So she goes to Deep Space Nine, meets Odo, and links his brains out. And in fact, Odo's so busy linking, having hot linking, that he misses his chance to help disable the deflector dish, which is going to be taking down the minefield, and gets Rom captured. At which point he's too linked out of his brains to realise, and Kira has a bit of an angry at him. And this is quite decent. Again, we're seeing, sadly, it was in the last episode as well, they talk about the resistance meetings, And I don't know, couldn't they be called gatherings or something? It just, a resistance meeting sounds like, okay, right, so first on the agenda, last week's business, how did the resistance get on? Okay, right, before we break up, any other resistance business? And indeed, you know, Odo's annoyed, I think it's in this episode that he's annoyed that he missed any other business at the last resistance meeting. I quite like the subtle putting the Dominion and the Cardassians against each other thing. That worked quite well. And indeed, it was interesting to see Quark almost coming on board, you know, in his, I've tried to just be the businessman, but I missed the Federation. I don't like the Cardassians as much. And again, elements of Quark there that you do see, you could argue that he could just be sitting there saying, profit's profit. If they're paying for their drinks, they're paying for their drinks. And I like this idea that he's saying, no, he does have preferences and standards, and that's quite neat. But yes, this sort of goes on. Indeed, the main thing is Odo being distracted by linking a lot with the female changeling and the breakdown with his relationship with Kira. And so that's again, we get a feeling things are moving, and that's the important part. One of the interesting things is, I think Sisko talks about the war being over when he's back in the station. I may go into this whenever we get back onto the station, but it's one of the reasons I'm looking for. There's some stuff I've read about this, which I'd be interested. Why I'm interested to see if that Deep Space Nine documentary materializes, because there's some interesting production stuff which I'll possibly talk more about when we're back in the station. But yes, until then, again, these are two decent episodes. They're maybe not ones that you'd seek out and say, "Oh yeah, I'm going to watch Behind the Lines." But they're good. They're an important part of the story. I think you'd be worse off if you didn't watch them. So they both move things along a bit, which I think is good. They don't all have to be classics, but it's good that they move things along. So all that remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I always enjoy the podcast, and I look forward to the next two episodes. Will they be before Christmas, after Christmas? I could throw in a preemptive Merry Christmas here. I'll throw in a preemptive Merry Christmas. Preemptive Merry Christmas to everyone, assuming we're not going to get another, and a preemptive Happy New Year as well. So until then, bye for now.
Bye, sir.
Bye,
thank
bye.
You. Health and safety, Purry in the house.
Yeah. it's adjutant, isn't it?
I think so, yes.
Yeah. And when you were talking about the resistance meeting, it did really remind me of that Red Dwarf episode, the name of which I forget, but it's the one where Clitoris comes up.
Oh, that's the polymorph one, yeah.
Yeah. And because you've got Rimmer's character, haven't you, sitting round, sort of, and his resistance is just meetings and agenda items, isn't it? And that's totally where my brain went when you said that. But these are decent episodes. They are. And yeah, they're not, oh, you must watch. But if you'd missed them, you're a bit like with Babylon 5, at this point anyway, Deep Space Nine, your later viewing would be diminished.
Yes. There is important plot stuff happening, even if sometimes there isn't as much interesting narrative going on as you might hope.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you to everybody who's fed back.
Thank you.
In terms of what's coming up next, well, there is our now traditional Christmas episode coming out on Christmas Eve. What could we be covering? Find out. Christmas Eve in the afternoon. Little prezzy from us. And then, yes, we do squeeze one more in for 2017. Yes. Thursday the 28th of December, we shall be recording bOrgCast 11.3, covering the last two of the sort of archy bit at the beginning of the season. Favour the Bold and Sacrifice of Angels.
Oh, I think I know what happens in Sacrifice of Angels.
Yes.
But I'm really not sure what happens in Favour the Bold at all. Kind of a stark contrast for me, anyway.
Mm-hmm. A couple of plugs before we finish.
As usual, do check out, if you haven't already, Black Dog Podcast and Hypnagoria.
Which is always really good at this time of year, because he pulls out all the stops for Christmas, does our Jim.
Yeah. But also, I'm not quite sure when it's going to be out, although I do think it's going to be this side of the new year. We guested on the Shonky Lab.
By accident.
Yes.
As we gate-crashed the Shonky Lab. With the Shonky Lab, how do you explain what the Shonky Lab is? Random topics of conversation for 45 minutes, basically, nowadays, isn't it?
Well, it's not. You know in advance what they'll be, but...
But there's no link as to what they all are. There's
not
no theme.
No, but...
So what were we talking about?
It was that either-or game.
Oh, bizarre either-or game, yes.
And the one previous to that was...
Bicycles or something?
No, that's the one that's out at the moment. The one previous to that was... I can't even remember because it's so random.
There you go.
I'm drunk. But the thing is, what's different about the Shonky Lab is that when they're recording, they do it live and you can join in on Mixlr.
Mm-hmm.
They have a chat room. Oh, it was reality TV.
Ah, there we go.
We ended up talking about Time Team for a little bit.
So, yeah, it's available on iTunes. Yes. And...
it's Rogue 2 Media.
Yep.
But all your podcatchers, look for Shonky Lab and you'll mm-hmm. find it.
Jolly good. Okay, well, we'll catch you for our Christmas special. Until then, chew bye.
Bye, bye.
Music at the beginning of this podcast was produced by the 86th Floor on YouTube and is used with their kind permission. All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only and no copyright infringement is intended.
Find our website at bOrgCast.libsyn.com.
And we have a YouTube channel as well.
You can find the bOrgCast playouts on Spotify for your listening pleasure.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send emails or MP3s to bOrgCast@gmail.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCastAmmo. Hashtag bOrgCast. Party gimmicks in the shop. Try the house of fun. It's quicker if you run. This is a chemist, not a jumping shop. Party heads, simple enough, clear. Comprehend, easily understand. Do you hear a pack of party heads with the colour tips?
Shut it down!